We're all set. Great. Welcome to everyone from the Aylmer Evangelical Missionary Church family, our friends in Aylmer, St. Thomas, Elgin County, and areas beyond, we trust. And we're so glad that you've joined us for our live stream gathering and worship time. We're going to start our little service this morning with some music, and because of the COVID cases in the area and our need to be careful, we don't have our live musicians here on site this morning, so I've imported some music. And so our first number is actually a quartet piece. It's originally Gaither music, ministering in Mindanao. Big part of my life was being part of a gospel quartet. And so we recorded a few things. It's on a slideshow, so you can follow the words or sing along with us. And we're using the piece from the Gaithers, Not Gonna Worry, Not Gonna Fret. And then Pete will bring our announcements and lead us in our prayer time. God bless you and welcome.
I'm not gonna fret. I'm not gonna speculate or contemplate what hasn't happened yet. I'm not gonna worry. He's got the whole thing in his hands. Ooh. I won't let it haunt me. I won't let it win. I'm not gonna ruminate or speculate or contemplate what hasn't happened yet. I'm not going to worry. He's got the whole thing in his hands. He's got the whole thing in his hands. He's got the whole thing in his hands.
Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that you've granted us the freedom that we have in this country. Lord, that you guide us in every way. And yet, sometimes that song, as I was listening to the words, I'm not going to worry. I know that there are those in our community who are worried, that the uncertainty of the days that lay ahead just bring uncomfort. Discomfort. Lord, I ask that you would bring peace, that you bring understanding, that you would bring a comfort that only you can supply and provide. We don't know what's going to happen in the days ahead, but we do know that you are sovereign over all. Lord, I thank you for our community, for Aylmer. Especially concerned with how many cases now that we've seen over the last number of weeks. And Lord, I ask that you would work in a very strong way here in Aylmer. that you would continue to heal, that you would continue to work through this worldwide pandemic. It just seems strange when I've read some of the things that have happened back years ago with the Spanish flu and the different plagues that have rocked this earth. And to think, well, this is all just history, and here we are today facing the very same thing. Lord, I ask that through this, first and foremost, that your name would be lifted on high, that your Son would be glorified, that more and more people would turn to you when they reach that point of despair where there is no place else to turn. So, Lord, may your name be lifted on high today, I pray in your holy name. Amen. Well, good morning. Well, as Ray has already mentioned, we are not even having live music this morning. But it was wonderful to have
We were alive when we recorded it.
It was nice to have a song this morning, even not being live. But certainly am looking forward to the day when the room is filled back up again, perhaps even overfilled. And I know that's possible. I know with all things through God are possible. But it does make us wonder, where are we going? Where are we heading? I'm looking at empty chairs, and it's very disheartening at times. But I got to tell you, all it does for me is make me drive even faster to God. It's the only place where we can go. It's the only place where we can go where there's hope. And I don't mean, well, I hope we get through this. It's not that at all. It's a hope of knowledge that comes through the Word. A few announcements that I have to make. Obviously, as many of you know, we are not gathering. There's three of us in the building right now. So the next number of weeks will probably continue to look just like this. As far as the next number of weeks, Ray is going to be speaking today again, as well as next Sunday. Chris is going to be coming on the 23rd of August. Anne will be speaking on August 30th, and Eddie on September 6th. Now, this could all change again, and we may even wind up going to pre-recorded. Not even sure. Pay attention to Facebook. Pay attention to the emails that Anne sends out weekly. And pay attention to YouTube as well and our website. But I'm going to say right now, for the next number of weeks, the doors are more than likely going to be closed. I will say for certainty, next Sunday, they will remain closed. I know we said 2 weeks. We have, I think Alex had said, 43 ongoing cases right now in Elmer. So we are wanting to continue to keep our distance from one another. Doesn't mean we stopped being church, though. Doesn't mean that at all. As a matter of fact, it's quite the opposite. We remain the church, and we work as the church. Even though these four walls contain three men right now, the church is alive and it's at work. So definitely continue to pray. Continue to seek God's guidance in every way, whether it be through how you relate with neighbors, friends, family, through your finances as well. I know for some, me included, it's hit work-wise. Job has now, you know, I'm glad that I've been working, but it's become very quickly decreasing in hours and stuff like that. So at the same time, I know that there is a light at the end of the tunnel, and that light is Jesus. And I'm so glad that we have that hope in our Savior. So with those few announcements, I would like to ask Ray to come on up again. Looking forward to his continuation of where he started last Sunday, and we'll see where it goes today. Come on up, Ray.
It's an awesome privilege to once again share the word and to be part of Brian's ministry here in Aylmer. And My messages from 1 Peter have very intentionally been intended to complement, not to replace what Brian is doing. And I've appreciated his ministry as he's led this congregation in these days of COVID. And so we're continuing to look at living as exiles in a post-COVID world. I named that very intentionally because even though we look back to returning to normal, I know that even after the pandemic is over and everything seems to be restored, we will have changed. All of us will have changed, and our world will have changed. The way we do things will have changed. And hopefully along the way, we've learned some new things, we've developed some creative things, and we actually are more engaging than we ever have been before. As I begin, I'd just like to read several verses from 1 Peter chapter 2. I'll be reading from verses 11 to 25 as we begin to contemplate God's word. My thoughts are really from verse 11, where I begin my reading, all the way to verse 22 of chapter 3. I know it's a long portion, but oftentimes to get the full message of Scripture, we need to not just limit ourselves to a little paragraph, but to try to take in the whole of what the Apostle Peter is saying to us. So I'll begin at verse 11. He says, "Dear friends, I urge you as foreigners and exiles to abstain from sinful desires which wage war against your soul. Live such good lives among the pagans that though they accuse you of wrongdoing, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day he visits us. Submit yourselves for the Lord's sake to every human authority, whether to the emperor as the supreme authority or to the governors who are sent by him to punish those who do wrong and to commend those who do right. For it is God's will that by doing good you should silence the ignorant talk of foolish people. Live as free people, but do not use your freedom to cover up as a cover-up for evil. Live as God's slaves. Show proper respect to everyone. Love the family of believers. Fear God. Honor the emperor. Slaves, in reverent fear of God, submit yourselves to your masters, not only to those who are good and considerate, but also to those who are harsh. For it is commendable if someone bears up under the pain of unjust suffering because they are conscious of God. But how is it to your credit if you receive a beating for doing wrong and endure it? But if you suffer for doing good and you endure it, this is commendable before God. To this you were called, because Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his steps. He committed no sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. When they hurled insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. For you were like sheep going astray, but now you have returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls." You might have noticed from the opening slide that I actually changed the title to my message. I was looking at the theme of happy to go down or something that looked like that, focusing on humility as I was contemplating this morning. But as the week developed increasingly, I had to focus on the theme of in his steps. And I'll bring that verse to highlight it for you in just a moment. But as I think of the thought of walking in Jesus' footsteps, it reminds me a lot of of an event that took place when I was just a young dad, and my first child, my oldest son, was somewhere in the neighborhood of about a year, maybe 13 months old. And so by that time, he was walking and he could wear his little boots. And we were living in Port Elgin at the time, and Port Elgin is the land of lots of snow. I always called it the land where the snow falls sideways. And I would be shoveling my driveway twice a day to keep it clear because it was constantly sifting in. And one morning I went out to shovel the sidewalk, and I plodded through some knee-high snow to get my shovel, and in behind me came my son Chris. And he called out, "Look, Dad, I'm walking in your footprints." It sounds kind of cute, but it's also incredibly scary. Do I really want to have him walk in my footprints? Do I really want him to go everywhere I have gone before? Or do I want him to follow a different path, a better path that maybe I have walked? But Peter tells us here in verse 21 of chapter 2 that Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his steps. There's no error in the footprints of Jesus. There is no discrepancy between who he is and what he does and the path that he lays out for us to follow. Last week, we looked particularly at the theme of identity, and that we are exiles and strangers in this world, that we are a royal priesthood because of our connection to Jesus, our great high priest. And we are reminded, Peter tells us, that we are a royal priesthood so that we might declare the praises of him who called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. In many ways, that statement echoes what Paul says in Colossians, where he says that God has transferred us from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of his dear Son. So the God calling us from darkness to light, he has brought us into the kingdom of Christ. We are citizens of Jesus' kingdom. And with being part of Jesus' kingdom, we find ourselves in a clash of kingdoms. Jesus, when he was on trial, said to Pontius Pilate, "My kingdom is not of this world. If it were, my servants would fight to prevent my arrest." This highlights how different Jesus' kingdom is. The kingdom, the empire of Rome that Pilate represented, was a kingdom of force and brutality. And here Jesus says that his servants, they don't even fight to prevent Jesus' unjust arrest. Paul even tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 and 4, he says that our weapons are not of this world. So the way that we engage our world is very different from the way in which our world might engage us. Maybe one way of illustrating this is one of Jesus' parables, the parable of the yeast. It's a one-verse parable. Jesus is a lot more compact speaker than I think I am. And Jesus said, "The kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and mixed into about 60 pounds of flour." I tell you, that's one ambitious baker. 60 pounds of flour, that is a lot of flour. "And she mixed it in until it worked all through the dough." Yeast is one of those things that it's small. It's something that we easily overlook. There's a certain sense, because we're dealing with a bacterial, microbial kind of a product here, that it's something that we turn our noses to and we despise in some kind of way. And yet it works unseen and it produces dramatic results over time. This week, Gloria and I, in our devotions, we've been following through a book called The Abundant Life by a much older missionary, pastor, speaker from a generation or two ago named E. Stanley Jones. And our meditation yesterday actually said that the church is like a seed plot. It's a seed plot for Jesus' kingdom, and that the established order around us goes through all of its activities, and it's destined for destruction. And yet when it fails, the church is there to express the kingdom of Christ, which is the new order that's going to replace the old one. In a way, it works like seed, like I mentioned last week, or like yeast in this parable. You see, Paul says that God chose the foolish things and the weak things, the things that are lowly and despised, to nullify the things that are. He says that Christ Jesus has become for us wisdom from God. So Jesus is the principle by which we live. And so Peter is teaching us that we're to be walking in the Jesus way. Peter's epistle is really about teaching us to walk in the footsteps of Jesus and what it looks like. And so as we come to this morning's extended passage that I trust you've taken time to read this past week, that we have to take note of Peter's purpose and what his objectives are. Peter's purpose is to prepare Jesus' followers for difficult times. They're living in the Roman Empire. Persecution is on the horizon. Upheaval is taking place. Probably by the time that Peter has written his letter, the Jewish wars that would have eventually led to the destruction of Jerusalem and the temple in AD 70, that there already was ferment among the Jewish nation for those things to take place. And so he's preparing them for these times. But he has a particular objective in mind. And that objective is that Jesus' followers would conduct themselves in such a way that their conduct would advance the spread of the gospel and the mission of Jesus in the world. Just take note of these statements in Peter's letter about his objectives here. He says in 2:12, that non-believers may see your good works and glorify God on the day he visits us. So in other words, that our lives would be so evident and so noteworthy that it would actually bring praise to God. What's meant by the day he visits us? It could be the time of trouble that's coming. It could be a time of historical judgment on the Roman Empire. It could also be referring to the final judgment. It may include all these things. Then he says in 2:14 that those in authority may commend those who do right. That's really more of an inference, but he says that the authorities are there to address those who do wrong and to condemn them and to punish them, but that they're to commend those who do what is right. In other words, that we as Christians would draw the attention of the authorities that we are doing good things and that we are a benefit to the community. He says in 3:1, for when he instructs wives, he does it so that non-believing husbands may be won over by the behavior of their wives. And then when we get to 3:15, part of the result of our lives ought to be so that we are prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks us to give the reason for the hope that we have. And so Peter has this objective, that we walk in the footsteps of Jesus, that we would be like him in our conduct in the world in which we live, even in our COVID world today and the post-COVID world that we will face in the future. So how do we walk in the footsteps of Jesus? What does it look like? And Peter explains it to us. First of all, Peter teaches us to behave humbly. This is in that whole section where we see that word submit that makes us recoil. I'm going to give a little bit of a word study here. There are three key words that I want to focus in on. Of course, one is especially the word submit yourself. The original word carries with it the meaning of to place or to order or to arrange under. So, for example, if you're putting together a building plan and you have to set your priorities of what comes first, then obviously putting the shingles on the roof takes a subordinate order to putting in a good foundation. And in essence, that is primarily how this word is meant to convey its meaning. It's to put things in their proper place, in their arranged order, so that life can function well. He says that we are to humble ourselves. We see that in 5:5. And then he repeats the little phrase, in the same way, which kind of ties the whole passage together. And so we need to take note, because all three of these words, submit yourself, humble yourself, and in the same way, are all woven together throughout this passage. But especially that word submit. I have a whole list of them here. I'm not going to read them all for you, but he addresses it to everyone, to slaves, to wives. He even actually addresses it to husbands, because for husbands, he says, well, in the same way, husbands, be considerate of your wives. That in the same way ties back to that whole command about being submissive. So we have to be careful here that we think that Paul is telling wives to submit, but husbands don't have to. I think part of the reality we recognize is that we need to be very careful in how we interpret this passage, how we handle it, how we apply it, because the world to which Peter wrote this, or the world in which he wrote it, and the people to whom he wrote it originally, who lived in that world, well, the Roman world was very different from ours. In the Roman world, very few had rights or freedoms of any kind. There was a rigid class structure. There was no sense of people being equal in a culture like that. And everyone had their place, and they were born into it, and very few people could ever rise above it or break free from it. And Peter basically is saying, you're living in this structured society, and in order to represent Christ well, you can't be kicking against it everywhere that you go. Order yourself to live in the society that we find ourselves in. So he says in verses 13 and 14, submit yourselves for the Lord's sake to every authority, even to the emperor, to Nero. Apparently so. But he tells us that we live as free men. In other words, as Christians, we have a freedom in Christ, and we've been set free, and there's something that is transforming us, and through changing us is going to transform the world in which we live if we just let that leaven do its work. So let's just take a quick look at this whole idea of submission once again. Well, what does Peter really mean by this? First of all, let's think of what he doesn't mean. He's not saying that we're to make ourselves into doormats, or that we're to let ourselves be abused. He's not telling us that we have no rights. An illustration I was going to use that I'll skip over later, for example, is when Paul was in prison in Philippi, after the Philippian jailer came to Christ, and the next morning the magistrates show up, and they were going to let Paul and Silas free that morning. And basically, Paul goes, don't be so quick there now, buddies. You should never have treated me the way you did, because I'm a Roman citizen. And then all of a sudden, they were very upset. I think one of the takeaways I get from that is Paul was very willing to receive the injustice, to show the injustice for what it really was, and then when he claimed his rights, the injustice was exposed. And so there's a certain sense in which, even as this passage unfolds, that the reason, one of the reasons why we walk in the footsteps the way we do, even the reason why Jesus suffered the cross the way he did, is that you don't defeat evil by using evil's tools. So I'm going to try to motor on through here, and we were talking about what Peter didn't mean and now what he does mean. And so when Peter invites us and commands us to submit willingly and of our own initiative, not being forced, that subjection, that is a violent act of violence. Peter is telling us here that we shouldn't resort to any kind of one-upmanship or a power play, that we don't have an insubordinate or an attitude on our shoulder, a chip on our shoulder all the time, that we don't escalate the situation, which really relates to what's going to follow in just a few moments, and that we should be wise about what we're doing, wise about our social ordering, because every workplace, every society does have a certain kind of an ordering. So, of course, you're going to recognize that your boss is in a position of authority over you, that that those in close relationship to you, like a spouse, has a say in your life, even a wife to a husband, and that we need to be wise about how we exercise our rights. And so Peter is teaching us all these things. I'm just going to quickly just jump through here, because with our little delay, I want to be sensitive for time. There's two very key verses that have been emerging a lot in these days of COVID circulating in the church community here in North America. The first is from Christ in Matthew's gospel, where Jesus says that we should give back to Caesar what is Caesar's and to God what is God's. And those who quote this most of the time are recognizing that we should be submitting ourselves to our national and civil authorities, and that in even in a situation like ours, you know, really what's asked of us is only what appears to be right. And yet we see some in the Christian community resorting to quoting Peter in Acts 5:39, where he says, "We must obey God rather than human beings." And that brings a tremendous amount of confusion. And I've wrestled with it this week, because some very prominent preachers are, especially south of the border, are very insistent about opening their churches again. And there's a certain sense of defiance with that. And I go, well, you know, are they right? Am I wrong? What's going on here? Some of it might be the local political situation, climate in which they find themselves. And yet I find myself also having this certain check that says, well, be careful that what you're really doing is obeying God and not just obeying your preferences. We all like to do what we want. And we see so much of that today, sometimes even leading to people creating great harm. So how do we respond to COVID? How do we live out this attitude of humility and submission in our world? And well, we should obey the warnings and the protocols and the mandates that come. We should respect our political leaders and those in medical leaders who are looking out for our best interests. At least for here in Ontario, I think I can very safely say our political leaders aren't telling us that we have to give up following Christ, that we can't worship anymore, but they're recognizing that for the public good, for everyone's benefit, that gatherings are things that we should be very, very careful about. And so we should be behaving in a humble way, is the primary thing that Peter is telling us. The second thing about walking in the footsteps of Jesus is that we respond justly. I'm reminded of the words in Micah that Jesus quotes in the Gospels, that we should do justly and love mercy and walk humbly with our God. And that's almost like another repeat of what Peter is saying through this whole passage. And so Peter says in verse 9, he says that we shouldn't repay evil for evil or insult for insult. This comes immediately after he says, finally, all of you live in harmony with one another, be sympathetic, love as brothers, be compassionate and humble. He's summarizing the last part and he's moving on to the next one now. And in essence, first thing we need to grasp is the first sentence, you know, finally, all of you live in harmony with one another, is addressed to the church. And then when he comes, do not repay evil for evil or insult for insult, he's now talking about our behavior in the larger community once again. And we need to recognize that the church is the greenhouse in which we learn and develop our following Jesus Christ together. Because sometimes we don't get along with each other, even in the church. And yet that's where we learn to develop these attitudes so that we can display them in the wider world and represent the gospel well. This teaching about responding justly, not repaying evil for evil, reflects Jesus' words where he says to turn the other cheek, not to, and then further on, you know, that follows after his saying, you know, not to resist an evil person. Or Jesus goes on and he tells us that we should love our neighbors and to pray for those who persecute us. And that part of the reason there is because, you know, justice isn't all in our own hands. And that even though we may require justice and even demand justice, that we have to do as Paul teaches us in Romans. In Romans 12, he says, do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it is possible, as far as depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Then he goes on, do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath, for it is written, it is mine to avenge, I will repay, says the Lord. I'll say a little bit more about that last phrase, but we need to recognize that are we looking for justice or are we really seeking revenge in the way that we react to being misused and mistreated by other people? A few weeks ago, as I was contemplating 1 Peter already, it was around that time that statue of Ulysses S. Grant was being torn down in the States. And it really caught my attention because the context in which that was happening seemed like there was something amiss with what was taking place, because the statue that was being torn down was of a person who fought in the U.S. Civil War to set black slaves free. And it just seemed so completely opposite to the message that was being communicated. And I quickly wrote down a thought that came, and I want to pass it on to you, that when we're determined to take justice into our own hands, injustice reigns. There are times when we think we're executing justice, and in doing so, we're actually creating a new injustice and possibly a greater injustice in our quest for getting what we think is just and right, and we've ended up resorting to revenge. And so we need to be very careful, as I've already said, we need to be wise about executing our rights, that what we think is just doesn't become something that's unjust. That's why repaying evil for evil or insult for insult actually perpetuates the problem and doesn't cure the injustices that we see in our world today. Well, how does this apply to our COVID situation? I think part of it is you might think you're being mistreated by being forced to wear a mask. Some people are very much feeling that way these days. Or being told that you should stay away from the beach or avoid other kinds of public gatherings and concentrations of people. And so you begin to push back and, oh, they can't tell me what to do and I have my rights. And yet the reality is, in demanding your justice to do what you want, what if inadvertently you didn't realize that you were a non-symptomatic carrier and you passed it on to someone else for whom the symptoms could be in the extreme and possibly even lead to their deaths? Have you not, in demanding your justice, created an injustice? And so we need to be creative. Yeah, there's only three of us in the church this morning. But I don't see that as a great setback, because the church isn't a building to begin with. And the church isn't just what we do in that wonderful hour or hour and a half that we designate on a Sunday morning. We are the people of God, whether we're gathered or scattered. And we can gather in a multiplicity of ways. Some of my friends are incredibly creative, and they've set up a Zoom coffee hour after their online church service every Sunday. There are ways that we can gather that we don't have to feel that it's just merely our physical presence. Your presence in someone else's life can be communicated through so many technologies. Just like yesterday, a dear friend of mine, actually a member of the quartet, yesterday was the anniversary of when his wife passed away from cancer. And I quickly sent a message to him over Facebook. I made my presence known. My doing that was just as effective and communicated the love of Christ just as much as if I had stood on his doorstep. And so there are many things that we can do that maybe a generation ago we couldn't, and our hands really aren't tied. So we are to behave humbly and we're to act justly, but then we should also live hopefully. Peter's already referred to this whole theme of hope, seems like half an hour or more ago. And Peter refers to this hope in this wonderful letter to the early Christians. And this hope is particularly emerges in chapter 3. And these are just a collection of statements from verses 13 to 22. He says, "Who's going to harm you if you are eager to do good? Do not fear what they fear. Do not be frightened. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give reason for the hope you have. But do this with gentleness and respect, keeping a clear conscience." And then he looks at the example of Christ. It's a confusing passage. He says things about baptism and Jesus going into the underworld and proclaiming to imprisoned spirits, and we kind of get lost in it all. But really all that is for, and Peter then goes and he brings it to a conclusion where he says, "For Christ died for your sins once for all, and that baptism saves you by the resurrection." So baptism doesn't save you. You're saved by the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at God's right hand. What's Paul saying in all this extended passage? He says, you don't need to be afraid, because if you look at Jesus' example, because you're walking in his footsteps, the pathway Jesus followed, yes, it led to a cross, but eventually he who humbled himself was exalted. And so, for example, I had you read from Philippians chapter 2, 1 to 11 this week. You know, where it says that, you know, we should have the same mind as Christ Jesus, who humbled himself and became a servant, even to the point of death on a cross. And that therefore God has highly exalted him, giving him a name that is above every other name. Peter's saying here that our ultimate hope is in the resurrection. It's in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Because Jesus rose from the dead, we too shall rise. And therefore, we don't have to fear. We don't have to be frightened. But people are afraid today. A lot of people are very afraid. But we have this hope that enables us to rise above our fears. I'm going to skip a slide here, Alex, to verses 13 to 15, where, you know, he says again, you know, who's going to harm you if you're eager to do good? Don't fear what they fear, but acknowledge in your hearts Christ as the Holy Lord. To acknowledge Christ means you look to him, you put your trust in him. He's your hope. It also is looking to him as our judge and as our master. In other words, he's the one that we turn to for our ultimate justice. We're given the example of Christ in this again in the scripture lesson that we read in chapter 2. And in verse 23, the very last verse of that section where it says that Christ suffered and he didn't return insult for insult. And even though he didn't commit any sin, and then it says at the end here that he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. That's why we can submit ourselves. That's why we can act justly, even in the face of injustices, because we're entrusting ourselves to a greater judge, a more important judge. There are many reasons why I believe in the existence of God and in the afterlife, but among them is this one. In the human heart is this longing for ultimate justice. But in this life, ultimate justice does not come. Think of how many people historically have died without receiving the justice they should have received. And yet we cry out for it and we long for it. And I think that's an expression deep in the human heart that demonstrates to us that there must be a perfect judge, and that one day there has to be an afterlife where there will be perfect justice. And so we can have hope in him, and we entrust ourselves just as Jesus did. I think that's why when we get to chapter 5 and verse 6, even though that's not in the scope of our passage today, we have to take note of it, where Peter tells us, "Humble yourselves therefore under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time." The path that Jesus walked, and when we walk in his steps, that's the path we walk. It's the path that demonstrates that though we carry a cross and though we suffer, when we humbly and submissively carry that cross, just as Jesus did, that we have this assurance that like he was exalted and lifted up, we too will be. There's something to look forward to that keeps us going, that enables us to live in a COVID world, even though we find it very challenging. We walk in the footsteps of Jesus. Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his steps, Peter tells us. Walking in the footsteps of Jesus, a key part of that is living humbly, acting justly, and living hopefully. As I think of the hope that's waiting for us this morning, a great old song came to mind. You can tell how old I am because I'm quoting from Rodgers and Hammerstein from a musical that probably came out probably even before my time. Many of you might remember the musical Carousel, and in it are these words that, for me particularly, are emblazoned in my memory because every Labor Day I heard Jerry Lewis sing it as part of his telethon for muscular dystrophy. When you walk through the storm, hold your head up high, and don't be afraid of the dark. And as the song concludes, it says, walk on with hope in your heart, and you'll never walk alone. You'll never walk alone. Probably the intent in the context of the original music was very different. But for us as Christians, we don't walk alone. We walk in the footsteps of Jesus. But Jesus he promises that he will never leave us or forsake us. And so when we walk in his footsteps and we follow the path of Jesus, we are with him. We can acknowledge him. We can be conscious of God, as Peter says in our passage this morning. And we can know that we can do it by the power of the Holy Spirit, walking with Jesus Christ in the path that he set out for us. And we do all this so that we can change minds and change hearts, to soften them for the gospel, so that it can do its work in our world. So as we live out the gospel, as we walk in Jesus' steps, we're living out the politics of Jesus' kingdom in our COVID world. And when we do that, we participate in and we advance the mission of Jesus. And we do that when we follow his example and we walk in his steps. Now let us pray. Heavenly Father, these words are very challenging. We recoil at them. We don't like the idea of submission. We feel that we're pressed into a corner and treated very unjustly when people make demands of us. And yet, Heavenly Father, you are teaching us to walk in the footsteps of Jesus in a way that transforms our world and even transforms our hearts. Lord, during these days, help us to not be filled with resentment and bitterness about what we are facing and the constraints that might be upon us. But Lord, we pray that even as Jesus embraced the cross, that we would embrace this time and use it as an opportunity to let our light shine, to exercise good works, to glorify God so that others will be drawn to Jesus. Father, we ask these things. We give you glory and praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Peter will lead us in our closing prayer and benediction in a moment, but I've chosen a second song this morning from my stash on my computer. And I know this song is familiar because I heard it sung here just a few weeks ago. And it's I guess because I don't listen to Christian radio way up north, and so a lot of music is new to me. But one of our young ladies from the Mindamoya Church sang it, and Marjorie Scott, who is the singer, is a high school graduate hoping to start at Laurentian University this fall, all Lord willing, and all things going well. And her dad is accompanying her. They produced this song for one of our online services. Up in Mindamoya a couple of months ago, and yet I think it's one that's very fitting for us, because as we walk in the footsteps of Jesus, and we know that it's hard, it reminds us to always keep our trust in him.
Letting go of every single tree, I lay each one down at your feet. Every moment of my wandering never changes what you see. I've tried to win this war, I confess.
Thank you.
Thanks, Ray, for the message this morning. You know, I was reading through the scripture at the same time as you were speaking, and you know, that part about repaying evil with evil, oh, that one's a hard one. That guy that just cut me off, he's going to get it. I know. I mean, no, I don't drive like that anymore, but there was a time when I did. I wanted to repay evil with evil, and I'm so glad that that the Spirit is slowly changing me. I pray and hope that the Spirit is changing you as well as we grow in Christ. But that's that one there. When I read that one, it's like, why do you have to say that, Lord? I really want to get that guy. But no, it's this is how we grow as the Spirit works through our lives and in us as well. To him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen. Though the doors may be locked, God is open for business. Go and serve your King.